Welcome everyone to another Dunedin Fine Art Center Digital Artist Talk here with Kwasi Bouldin today, one of our four inaugural candidates for our new Nomadency Digital Residency Program. We're so honored to have Kwasi with us. And also with us is Catherine Bergman, our curatorial director, and Cassie Combs, our communications director, all of whom have played a very big hand in shaping this program, this new program, which we are delighted to say did have the far reach that we were hoping for. Kwasi, you're in LA. A couple of our other folks are one from Washington, one local in Dunedin, and another from Florida. So it's a nice, kind of a nice look at what's going on out there digitally. And the purpose of the program, of course, is to kind of take a look at digital art, the state of digital art, and what's happening now. And we did want to include AI as part of the conversation if it came up. Kwasi, one other thing I should mention is that all of the artists developed proposals and projects around the notion of play, which is our overarching theme for this fall's exhibits, physical exhibits at the Art Center. So Kwasi, tell us about yours. Yours is called Playground.
Yeah. Well, first of all, thanks for, having me. I'm really honored to be one of the inaugural Nomadency residents, and it was a really great opportunity. So when I saw the idea, the proposal that as it went out, Playground was kind of the first thing that popped into my mind. I mean, there's lots of ideas and concepts around play, and I think that, you know, you can go anywhere, you know, with just the term, but, you know, for me, the idea and concept of a playground, something that just goes back to, you know, to my happiest times when I was a kid. I was a big park kid. I was a big playground kid, obviously. And it's just something that, you know, at least in Los Angeles, I'm not sure if it's like this in Florida or in other places, but at least in Los Angeles, that, you know, that was like a really big part of being a kid, was going to these different playgrounds, and you would have different friends at different playgrounds, and just, you know, different parks. Like if you went to a new park, it was almost like going to like an amusement park. It was just like, oh, they have this and that sort of thing. I really liked that concept of, I really wanted to build on that concept. And it also tied into some of the thoughts I have about space as a photographer, and about like the lives that these spaces have and how interacting with them influences ours. So that was kind of like that was my thought process behind, you know, that was behind the initial concept.
Yes. We're not unfamiliar with your work, of course. Back in 2018, we had some of your photography in a show called Triangulate. It's a traveling international show, which was really fabulous. And little did we know that that kind of photography, your street photography of LA, would end up again in something that we've curated for our gallery spaces. You did all the background photography for a show called City of Ghosts. And so now it really feels like you're starting to meld a series of paintings that you have with digital aspect, with photography. So tell us more about the coming together of all of these things.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, you know, for pretty much my entire life, I've always been an artist. So I've always drawn, I've always painted, analog sorts of arts, when I started out. And photography was something that, you know, became really important in my life as I got older. When I was 19, that's kind of when I first got a camera. And then, like, you know, my 20s, it became a really large part of my practice and became the dominant part of my practice for a while. Although I never stopped drawing and I never stopped making these sorts of things. I'm a graphic designer by trade, so I'm always making things. But really, it you know, over time, I really did long to, you know, I found some success as a photographer, and I really have always just been struggling with this idea of how do I tie it all together into one voice? How do I kind of elevate, you know, the sort of things that I do in other mediums to the place that I had found with my photography? And like, that was really like my ultimate task, I'd say, over the past like 4 or 5 years was bringing these pieces of myself together. And honestly, like it kind of unveiled itself over projects. City of Ghosts actually had a really big influence on me melding these together in a way, because it working on the show kind of unlocked it. I was like, oh, like I'm taking these pictures and I'm seeing what people are doing with these pictures, and I'm working on this show and I'm part of this great team. And it just gave me a lot of ideas about where I could possibly go and how I could, you know, just maybe bring some other things together. So, and then from there, I just started playing. And, you know, I mean, you know, iPad is our friend and Procreate is our friend. And like I said, I'm a graphic designer. And so like, I always just kind of bring these things in, and that's kind of the, you know, I'd say that's the foundation of the style that, you know, I submitted to the residency.
I didn't realize that about you, but it's no surprise that you have your background as a graphic designer. that's where your workaday life started. Is that right? As a designer?
Yeah. It's been, I mean, you know, it's been my kind of craft since I've always had an interest in design. So I mean, my roots in design go back as far as my roots with you know, art in general. And you know, that's what I have my degree in. And you know, I usually work in higher ed doing design for like institutions. Like right now I work at USC. But that's kind of that's always been the foundation in which I you know, build this stuff on, and it keeps it fresh. It gives me an advantage in the way that I know how to frame things, and I know how to pull things together and present them. And that's actually a big part of my artwork too. So, I mean, it all becomes the same thing after a while.
Yes.
Here's one of the pieces that we have in the City of Ghosts show. And this is acrylic paint marker on paper. And you can see a lot of the parallels to what you made for the Nomadency project. Is this the first digital kind of residency that you've ever done?
Absolutely. I mean, and that was kind of one of the reasons I was really interested in it, because in some ways it was a challenge for me, because, you know, I work a lot digitally, as my day job as a designer, but you know, traditionally my fine art or the art that I do for myself is more so physical. I like to draw. I love pen and ink. I love painting. I love things like that. And I've been working, you know, towards, you know, kind of, you know, getting that synergy, like I said, like, you know, getting that together and having it kind of come across digitally in a way that I felt really good about for a while. And so I really just looked at this as a challenge to create something specifically to be digital. And to tie in a lot of the elements that I have in my physical, you know, analog artwork, and to also bring in my photography into it too. So that was really my primary, you know, interest in the Nomadency, in the residency, was just, I wanted to create something, you know, that was on equal footing, I felt, with my physical work. And that was really, you know, not just an experiment, not just something for Instagram, but just like you know, specific pieces for a specific purpose. And so like, that was one of the main reasons I was interested in participating.
Nice. Now, you've got two daughters.
And you, yes, I do.
Are they still interested? Are they still interested in the playground, or are they too old these days?
You know, well, my older one, she's I mean, my oldest one is 10, so they're both still young. You know, I have a 10-year-old and I have a 7-year-old, but you know, she's, you know, middle school is coming up next year. She's aging out a little bit, you know, but, you know, I think having a little sister always brings it out of her. And so she, you know, if we go to a playground, she's always game to play with her little sister and stuff. She's very good at that. And they're close enough in age that they're really good friends. So that's always, you know, they're, you know, we, but I think those days are numbered for her, you know. I mean, things are just, you know, getting a lot more, you know, she's into other things, but fortunately she's, you know, they're both really creative girls, and they both have an interest in like the outdoors and things like that. So I think we'll find a way to extend that general interest. But yeah, the playground for her is, you know, she's kind of like the supervisor on the playground. She's not as into it, you know, as you know, my youngest one is still like, you know, getting dirty and doing all that stuff. And she's kind of like, you know, so it's a different thing.
I liked what you wrote about in your proposal about your own experience on the playground as a kid. And what I recall too with my own daughter is those instant relationships, those instant friendships, as you say, and then specific to each location. I also loved how this project focus on playground and your work with City of Ghosts and your work in general, capturing neighborhoods and preserving the life of neighborhoods, how they, that sort of all speaks to one another, because playgrounds, whether they're being born or they have gone defunct, have such a history in community.
Absolutely. I mean, and a lot of that, you know, that's a really good point. I'm really glad you brought that up, because I think that, you know, buildings, libraries, all these sorts of schools, you know, all these sorts of, you know, places within the neighborhood do really kind of contribute to the overall atmosphere and like life of it. And playgrounds are very much in that vein, parks in general, but, you know, playgrounds specifically. And, you know, it is kind of a meeting place. And that, you know, that ability to randomly make friends because you just happen to be at a playground. I mean, you know, there was no pre-sorting. There was no like self-selection. You're just there. And like, oh, well, your kid, that kid's about my age. You know what I mean? Like, we can probably figure something out interesting to do. Like, that was a really powerful part of growing up for me. And I think that, you know, I wouldn't say it's lost, because I you know, I thought it was disappearing for a while, but then I had children and I see it still happening. I mean, I don't think in the same way as, you know, when I was a kid, but nothing happens the same. So I still see it happening, and it's one of those things that's like, there's a lot of pre-selected connection in our world. And so like, I cherish like these organic friendships that happen. And that fuels my interest in neighborhoods too, in terms of like documenting like bus stops, and just, I like randomly meeting people and just, you know, just having, you know, just documenting these random reactions. And so, you know, playground is still one of the places that, you know, it's still kind of the heart of that for really little kids. And I think that that's an important, you know, part of growing up.
Yeah, when you talked about, sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, so far, you're our third artist we've spoken to, Kwasi, and we have one yet to go, but everyone has had children so far, which I find interesting. But play, whether you're a parent or not, as an artist, play is just so integral to the practice of art, it would seem to me, or I would hope for most artists, that they would allow themselves that, and that would generate, you know, that would generate the explorations and experimentations.
No, I would definitely agree with that. I mean, the children thing is actually pretty funny. But I mean, I think it's a universal sentiment, clearly, with artists, you know. And I think that because you have to play in order to create in some ways. You have to kind of try these things without, you know, like, I don't really make things for my artistic side of, you know, my practice under pressure very much, you know. I mean, you know, I'm a graphic designer. When I have photo projects, City of Ghosts is full of pressure everywhere. Like, so like this sort of thing is like, there's no pressure. Like, you know, so like you can experiment. And that's why, like, you know, even with my social media accounts, like I have a couple of them, but you know, my main art one, I just kind of put stuff out. I kind of like test things, and you know, it's not really about likes or engagement, or like, I'm not trying to game the algorithm. Like I really do kind of like seeing how people react to it. And that's kind of a form of play for me also. So yeah, I would definitely agree. Like, you have to, you know, if you're lucky, you can incorporate it into your life and find some space where there isn't some pressure. You just do things because you like doing them. You know, so yeah, I would agree with that.
I like these shapes, that they, these abstract background shapes, and maybe I'm going off the deep end here, but like there's something when we talk about the, you know, the memory of our own childhood and playing on a playground, these shapes remind me of those kind of pockets of memory. You know, they're kind of nebulous and abstract. But I wonder, who would you count as any influences on that, on your style? And this translates also to your physical painting and drawing.
Well, I mean, I have a lot of influence. I mean, I really do try to absorb as much as possible. I'm a really big fan of Murakami. I'm a really big fan of Basquiat. I'm a really big fan of of anime and animation in general, which is why one of the reasons I was so excited to work on City of Ghosts, because I love animation. I was like, I never thought I'd work on an animated show, and then I found this really cool way to be a part of one. So like that made it for me. But also like, you know, artists, you know, like Cody Hudson, who does things under the name like Struggle Inc. He does really interesting things with shapes that are just really just very simple, a lot more simplistic than mine. But like I really got attracted to, and this happened during the pandemic when, you know, everyone was just home and we had a lot of time, or not everyone, but I was, you know, and, you know, I really got attracted to making these shapes that didn't necessarily have a relationship to a real object, so that, you know, in a lot of ways I can kind of dictate what people are reading or what people are experiencing kind of through color and like choices and like, you know, I kind of stray away from hard lines because that kind of adds more definition to it. And so that kind of was the root of it. And in a lot of ways, you know, in a strange way, that's kind of rooted in my photography, because like one of the criticisms that I got early on as a photographer was that, you know, I didn't have people in my pictures, like, because I do urban landscape, like that's pretty much my thing. And so like that was when I was first learning photography, like, you know, that was kind of one of the things people say, well, oh, there's no people. But I really liked that, you know, without people, you absorb and you really look at the scene, because the second a person is in a photograph, they become the subject of the photograph. And so that's kind of a thought that ended up kind of permeating into my paintings, into like my more abstract work, is like by not necessarily placing a recognizable object within these shapes, like it kind of gives you a little bit more room to kind of explore and to like, you know, and it's interesting to see how people interpret it.
I love the palette in your paintings and your digital work, the transparencies, the layering, and the organic shapes in contrast to the line drawings. But I'm telling you, I see some fabric design in your future. Yes. And I also see book covers. I want to see your artwork on book covers when I go to the bookstore. That would be fun, wouldn't it?
No, that would be great. I've thought about rugs, I will say that. Like, I have a real interest in, like, rugs. I was like, this may be a thing. I more than a passing thing, that may be a thing that may appear on my website in some form. But but yeah, I'm just, I really like that. I just really like, you know, using color and kind of shape to kind of, you know, create, like, a surface or a experience for people to interpret in themselves. But, you know, there's some thought behind it, but like, you know, I definitely like that, that, you know, free kind of interpretation of it.
And the appearance of the truncated trees, there's something so tender. I love them graphically, but there's something so tender about that with, as we clear lands and build and, you know, alter the landscape, there's just something very touching to me about those elements.
Yeah, the tree branches are relatively new. I mean, by new, I would say maybe the past like 2 years. But it is definitely like a recurring theme. And it really got kind of, you know, I got really into, like, I have a small garden. It's a cactus garden. I have like lots of succulents. It's a thing that became a really big thing that my wife won't let me buy anymore. But I have a lot. And you know, I'm really intrigued by you know, the way that you can cut a succulent and you can plant it and can grow another one, and like I really like that sort of regeneration. And you know, in terms of like the branches, like, you know, I always envision them as like pieces of a greater whole that have the opportunity to grow into something different but the same. And like a lot of that reflects in like, you know, about like me and my family, about being African American, about everything. It's just like, you know, so like that's kind of, you know, I mean, no pun intended, but that's kind of like the root of the branch thing. You know, it's like, you know, like that is, and I've just really been kind of developing that as a concept. But it also ties into the environment, which is something that, you know, as I've gotten older, I've gotten really a lot more thoughtful about, and wanted to bring elements of that into not only my fine artwork, but also into like my photography and things like that. So there's probably a lot more of that coming in. I do a lot of staring at leaves and a lot of staring at textures and things like that. And that's a really big, you know, influence. It normally takes a while for these things to find itself into my work, but I've been kind of obsessed for about like 2 or 3 years. So it's probably coming.
That's great. I have a question. I think I read somewhere that you were a skateboarder.
Oh yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
So did that play any part in your artwork and your photography?
Yeah, no, me being a skateboarder is like the core, like I was into skateboarding and I was into graffiti. And like, those are like the core things of my life when I was a child. I skateboarded for like 12 years. I was pretty good at it. Until I stopped because, you know, life happens. But I skateboarded from about the time that I was 12 to about the time that I was 23. And honestly, like, you know, it's very different now because skateboarding is very accepted. Skateboarding is in the Olympics. Like, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, but when I skateboarded, like, this is like late 90s, you know, or 90s in general, like, you know, it was a very counterculture thing. And in Los Angeles, it was super counterculture. This was when street skateboarding was really blowing up. Like, you know, prior to that, when I first got into it, it was like, oh, you needed to find a ramp and you needed to find this and that. And then, like, you know, by the time I really got heavy into it, it was like all about like the urban environment. So like exploring the urban environment, like with my friends, like on a skateboard doing that, like that's how I learned how to see. And that's how I really learned how to kind of, you know, relate and connect with it. And like my favorite thing about skateboarding was that it was both like a communal and a solo sport. I love skateboarding with my friends, but I also loved going out by myself to work on things that I would debut or like show my friends that I had next time I saw them. So like I would leave the house at like 8 in the morning and just go skate, and I'd round up with my friends around 11. And then I'd skate with them until like 6. And then afterwards, this is obviously in summer, not during school. You know, and then afterwards, you know, I would skate from like 6 to like 9 in front of my house just working on things. So like there was like a lot of like discipline, but it was like a self-discipline. Like I wanted to be good. So like I worked really hard at it. And like that's one of the things that kind of taught me a lot from it also.
That's awesome. Yeah.
How old were you when you came to Los Angeles?
Oh, I like to say I'm technically born in New York. I was 2. So like, yeah, I'm like 100% like LA, you know, LA bred, not born, but bred. Okay. But I have a ton of family that's still in New York and in New York and, you know, Brooklyn in particular. So that's a place I have a relationship with. And, you know, like that's where, you know, there are places in Brooklyn where everyone's my cousin. So, you know, that's kind of still that place. And my dad is from New York. My grandfather grew up in Harlem. Like, I mean, so New York is a very big part of like my family life.
I'm just taking a look at all the other things you do here, Kwasi. It's, I know you just came out with a new book and you've got a bunch in your shop here, you know, so it's just really amazing to see all the different media that you use and the ways that you try to get your work out there and preserve your legacy. And I want to brag on you a little bit about your accomplishments. I mean, you know, we should feel so honored to have you with us. You were named one of the top 12 African-American photographers to follow in 2017. And you know, that's, I think that's where I found your work, actually, when I was looking for artists for Triangulate, was on that list. And I feel like this one's another pretty prestigious one, the Creator in Residence for the Los Angeles Public Library. That's pretty cool, you know, so we're really lucky to have folks like you sharing your work with us. Gives us a, you know, another view into the universe.
No, thanks. I appreciate that. I mean, and honestly, like, I mean, the timeless was, you know, getting on a timeless was pretty much like, I was working as a photographer before that, but like that, you know, clearly like turbocharged what, you know, where I was going. And, you know, I was really thankful. I have no idea how it happened. Like it was a great thing to have just happen. So I, you know, but I mean, the work I did with the library last year as a creator in residence was really nice also. Just because I have a relationship with the library going back a long time also. And it was really, you know, it was really great to be able to work on a project for an organization or a concept that I really, you know, believe in. You know, I believe in like the free spread of knowledge. I believe in like, you know, safe spaces for people to go and learn. Like these are all things that I'm 100% behind. So when they asked me, I was just like, yeah, of course. You know, and I appreciate you know, noting that. And you know, I really like working with, you know, I've been working with you all for a really long time now too. It's like, it's crazy where the years have gone. Like it's been 2018, like, you know, but yeah, I mean, I'm really glad we crossed paths because it's like, I don't have, you know, I really like, you know, having these sorts of relationships with people and like, I don't have any sort of, you know, foothold or, you know, no one in that part of Florida is aware of my work, but through y'all. And like, that's like, you know, and I really like that you all are an art gallery, like in Florida, like that's like a really nice relationship for me to have. So hopefully we can find some ways to continue to kind of collaborate, but like, yeah, the feeling's mutual. I'm very happy to be here.
Yes. Thanks to Nathan, truly, for finding you. And then in 2020, right, you were named one of the 5 art accounts to follow at the New York Times. What happened to your life at that moment?
You know, that was really a crazy time because of the pandemic. I mean, like, honestly, like the pandemic was really, it was both tough and looking back and pivotal, but it was tough because, you know, it came at a point where as a photographer, things were really starting to roll for me. I was getting a lot of work. I was doing a lot of work for Curbed LA, for Vox Media. And then, you know, everything shut down and my biggest clients went out of business. So like the publications just went under, like they just disappeared. So, you know, so that was a tough time for me, but like the way that I, you know, kind of just got through and just kind of kept plugging away was like, you know, I would just go out and just take pictures of what was happening during this weird, strange time in Los Angeles. And a person at the New York Times who I was friends with on Twitter when Twitter was a nice thing and not what it is now, saw my work and he was the person that ran that account for New York Times, and that's how it came across. And it was really great to see someone like recognize what I was doing as like a thing that should be elevated, especially, you know, the New York Times, but really like because I was really working in kind of a bubble. Like I didn't really have any feedback or, you know, we weren't going out to galleries. I wasn't going out meeting people. Like it was just like, you know, I was like, okay, honey, I'm going. And like, I would go, I'd be gone for a couple hours and come back. And like, that was my thing. But it was also the first time that I got a newspaper with like my picture, like in print. Like I have a ton of digital work out there, but like, that was the first one that actually made the art edition. And it was like the big picture in like the New York Times art edition on like a Sunday. It was, so that was like, you know, from a personal feeling, like I know to like my daughter's newspapers are like irrelevant, but like to me, like that was like a really big thing. And so like that was kind of, you know, that was a very big thing.
Yes.
Awesome.
Yeah. Amazing.
Now I wanted to ask you about you. I saw somewhere that you've done work with KCRW. Who you know, we love to listen to all across the nation. Yeah,
KCRW approached me. Well, I was on a show with them. They came to me for the work that I was doing. I did a series called Black Space, basically about Black Los Angeles, but from a landscape perspective, and that's kind of what drew them to me. And I had a really nice conversation with them on the air. Like, I don't know if it went national, if it was just like our local one. They have that really complicated network of stations, but it was really cool because they were interested in the way that I was approaching documenting these spaces that were disappearing. And, you know, that's kind of my whole thing, even with the work that I'm doing digitally, kind of like with incorporating the line drawings from my photos into it. It's just like, I like photographing these spaces because these spaces are, they're only here for a moment. And that moment might be our whole lifetime, but it really is just a moment. And then when they're gone, like, you know, there's no record of them. Like, I always joke, like whenever I see something change in the city, I notice it immediately because I'm always looking at these things. But, you know, I'll bring it up to like my wife or to someone else and they'll be like, oh, I don't even remember what was there. And like, it's just like, so it's because it's one of those things, like, I think as human beings, like, it ends up being like background noise. And so like in our daily commutes, like, you know, we just walk past things and like when they're gone, we can't remember what was there because it's like, you know, you never paid attention to it. And I feel like that was a lot what was going on with like the neighborhoods I was covering in Los Angeles. And that's kind of what I talked to KCRW about this is the Black Space project that Nathan is showing right now from my website, but this even predates that. This was the KCRW stuff was like the idea that spawned this project, which is a collaboration with my nephew, who's a historian. But it was just something that I thought that people were not really paying as much attention to. And, you know, I was really fortunate that they chose to kind of like, you know, highlight it a little bit with me.
Thank you.
I've always known you as more of a documenter, but are you interested in letting people use your images for activism or anything like that? Or, and what I mean by that is like, you know, neighborhood preservation or what have you. Is that something you want people to use your images for, or is it you're more in the documentation realm?
You know, I think I'm more in the documentation realm. It's an interesting kind of like, you know, there are interesting sides to it. I think that, you know, for me, I always, you know, I one of the things that's always fueled my art has kind of been, you know, like my perspective on it. So I think that that's a really strong influence on it, on me. So for me, I am always interested in like collaborating to do activism or these sorts of things, but I'm very, with the exception of City of Ghosts, which was a project that I got paid for, like I never like give people my photos. And like, that was one of the things that was like, you know, a very difficult thing for me with City of Ghosts is like, you know, for the first three episodes, like I was just taking all these pictures and I never saw anything. I was just trusting them completely. Like it's like, oh, we shot for 3 days. I've given you 3,000 pictures. I hope this turns out well. Like, you know what I mean? Like, because they're animators, like they really had a whole different process that I wasn't a part of. But you know, I knew it was, I felt really good when after, you know, after a while, like, you know, Elizabeth and the other directors started sharing, you know, oh, here's a snippet of this or here's that. And I was just like, oh my goodness, like, this is like exactly like we're on the same page, even though like, you know, prior to that, I'd never really worked with anyone who really saw LA in like the way that I was trying to present it. So to answer your question, kind of going back, like, I think that like, I like having a hand in the way the photos are interpreted, but you know, I manage it a lot too. That's one of the reasons why, like, I've taken a lot of stuff down from my website and like put up very selective things. And like, I'm trying to be more intentional about how I manage it. I mean, not only just in terms of like, you know, AI and Google scraping and all of that, but also because like, I just want to be really thoughtful about what I put out there. And then also because I draw from my own archive, like I don't want necessarily all of the references that it may end up in my digital work or in my paintings or anything out there for everyone else to do, because like, this is like, you know, this is the story that I'm trying to tell. So, so I guess the answer, yeah, more documentary. Yeah.
Now I have a couple questions. One is, with your work with City of Ghosts, would they say we're going to have a storyline in this neighborhood and then you'd go to that neighborhood and capture, or did they springboard from what you were providing?
You know, it was actually, it was very detailed. And I mean, we had a storyboard. So like every episode they gave me a storyboard and they're like, these are the shots. And we would go, and like they would have scouted the neighborhood, and there were some scenes that were super specific. That was maybe for the first episode or two. But after that, I think that as we got to know each other, because this was very new for them too, like, you know, we would get the storyboard, but there was always parts of every episode or every project where they'd be like, oh, well, we need these sorts of things. I'd be like, okay, I'll be back. You know, give me an hour, blah, blah, blah. I take pictures by myself. I'm not really like a big, you know, like, it's just better for me to take pictures by myself. And so unless there were specific things that needed to be photographed, I would just go off on my own. Sometimes I would go off, they would give me an assignment, I would just go, and there would be no big crew day. It would just be like a Kwasi day, and I would go and just film them or whatnot. So it ended up being a little bit of both of those kind of perspectives, but especially with the areas that I was really familiar with, like I would say, primarily the Koreatown episode, because so much of the Koreatown episode is from the neighborhood I grew up in. A lot of that was like, just go take some pictures, you know? And so like, I was able to really kind of put my stamp on that one a lot. Like there's so many scenes in that neighborhood that like, I'm just like, you know, there wasn't really a storyboard for it, that it was just kind of like, I just took some pictures and like, it ended up being loose enough for them to incorporate it.
I loved how they, for instance, there's the one scene with the ghost in the alley, and it's sort of a little altar, and there's a ghost that's kind of hiding out in the bush, and how they had animated some of the leaves. Mm-hmm. You know, they're like half circle shapes, mm-hmm, that look like leaves, and you know, to layer the animation on top of the photography. And then they did alter the photography, did they not, a little bit, to just in terms of visual consistency and texture?
Oh yeah, no, totally, yeah, for like color palette and things like that, yeah, absolutely. I mean, Chromosphere, that's the animation studio that did the work, they did an incredible job. Like I literally could not imagine what they did and how they even approached it, but it really was pretty much perfect, like no notes. Like it was a very phenomenal sort of, you know, collaboration that they did. And I think that, you know, because I draw also, I really had an advantage that I think that maybe some other photographers may not have had, because like I was able to envision kind of the scene as a photograph. And that sort of ability is what carried over to kind of the stuff that I've done with photographs since then. Is, you know, just being able to see the scene and kind of being able to imagine it as a 2D, as a two-dimensional frame, as opposed to just a photograph of space. And like, you know, that was something that like, I think being an artist was very helpful. Like, I mean, there were a couple of times I get a storyboard and then they'd be like, we need this shot. And it's like, well, that shot's not possible because you cheated on the perspective. Because I can tell, because as an artist, you can just change a line, you know, but when you get to a space, you can't do that. You know, so I have to find a different shot. So things like that, like I think there was definitely an advantage being an artist, you know, working with them on that too.
Well, one of my other questions then too was your tools. So you're using for your digital work, the tools you mentioned, Procreate, but for your photography, you're using digital cameras, or are they fancy cameras, or using?
I use very unfancy things on purpose. I'm not a fancy person. So, I mean, my digital work is, I mean, I do have, it's fancy-ish. I mean, I have a Canon R6. I have a very nice lens that goes with it. And that's like my main kind of like work camera. If I get an assignment or, you know, something like that. But I also have a lot of smaller digital cameras that I use for For art stuff, I use my iPhone a lot for art stuff. In fact, all of the inputs for the Nomadency series were all just iPhone shots. Because an iPhone is great. And like, there's really like, especially if you're going to be drawing from a photo, that is like the best thing to do. Like, I don't need to carry a big thing with me. I can get whatever angle I need, and it's the perfect thing. And it reproduces exactly the same way when I take it into, when I draw from it. And, I do use Procreate. I also use a program called Adobe Fresco, which is basically Adobe's version of Procreate, just because it has a nice Lightroom integration. And that's what I use primarily to assemble these, just because I find with Fresco, the ability to import my photo directly from Lightroom and just work directly on it with the iPad and then just delete that photo and kind of go from there. It's a really nice workflow. I use Procreate mostly for my paintings, my digital paintings that don't have line work with them. So I guess I draw better in Fresco, or I feel like I do, or I have more fun drawing better in Fresco, but I like the painting aspects of Procreate better, if that makes sense.
Thank you. Yeah.
Is there any other questions from Cassie or Catherine?
I don't think so.
It's been really fun. Like, yeah. I feel like I walked through Los Angeles, kind of.
Nice. If you ever find your way,
I just had one more quick question for you about your foray into digital, purely digital. Mm-hmm. Will these be available as prints someday, or do you want to put them in a book? Or I know you're a big fan of books.
Yeah, I am a big fan of books. And I think that, I am looking for, so basically with this series and with a lot of the things that I'm working on now, I do feel like there's some sort of book publishing, not a zine, nothing crazy, or not like a big tome or anything like that, but I do like printing digital things in physical form, just because I still think physical forms is really an important thing. I like that when I print out zines or I print out the books, and like, if I'm out or if I go to like a book fair or a zine fest and I'm selling them, I like that I can just hand it to someone and there's no interface. And I think it's interesting creating things digitally that can be reproduced in that way. And so I do think maybe there will be a book coming out of this sort of stuff. The book that I have on my website right now, Secret Schematic, has some digital stuff in it. And it also has some of my analog stuff in it. And I feel like that was a very good kind of like template for like the sorts of things I'd like to continue making.
Do you ever think about collaborating with a writer?
This one here. Just
what you call us. Oh, if you go to shop,
we've got your website here.
Collaborating with the writer would be cool. I'd love to.
Almost there.
I like collaborating.
So we got your website. To be honest. I know you're got several Instagram. Several Instagram accounts. Do you want to share any of those that people can check you out?
I have several Instagram accounts, but the main one is Non-Standard. Non-Standard is like the core to everything. You can find out anything about me by going to the Non-Standard account. So Non-Standard is basically the main one. I like making stuff. I love collaboration. I love sharing, I like the exchange of thoughts. Like, you find a like-minded individual that does something that you don't do. It's always fun. So, it's definitely good.
All right. Thanks a lot, Kwasi. It's been a pleasure talking to you today.
No, this has been a very pleasant way to spend a Friday.
It's early here yet, is it? Or is it?
We're at 11:45 for me. Yeah, it's still the morning. Yeah, I still have to do some things for like my day job later. And then, it's Friday. It's going to be a good weekend. So it's really hot here.
Ooh, it's actually getting cooler here.
Yeah, we have, it's going to be 96 today. Yeah. We're in it right now. But you know, hopefully it won't last, but I think the next couple of days it's going to be, and I live in the San Fernando Valley, which is hotter than like the LA basin in general. So yeah, you know, inside AC, that's all you can do.
Well, have a great weekend, Kwasi.
Thank you. No,
thanks a lot. And once again, you know, thanks for having me as part of the program. It's always fun working with you all. And I'm sure we'll cross paths again very soon.
I hope so. Okay.
Yes, definitely.
Right, have a good one. Bye-bye.
Bye.